Holiday in Durban. On the way to Durban, a cart made from bits of an old truck pulled by animals, and another one. This kind of transportation is still seen in that part of Africa. And now we're on the main freeway, as it was at the time, and heading toward Durban. I notice we've got a lot of what looks like corn there. Now we're going down the hill into Durban, and in the distance you see the downtown core with all the tall buildings. The Hotel Lonsdale was where we stayed. That was a favorite place to go for vacations. The hotels in Durban varied in price according to how close they were to the beach. We were about 3 blocks. Now we're looking out the window at the docks. And across the other side of the water, that tall range there is it's part of the Bluff. Now we're up in the Berea, which is a rather upscale part of Durban, at the time anyway. We're looking over the race course and toward the city in the background, so it's a bit further away than it was previously. The horse racing track. So we're with a party of tourists who've gone here for a tour of the city. We stopped for tea on top of this place. I remember being back at the very same spot a few years later as a student for a party of some sort. Zulu dancing was a very popular thing. The tourists would pay to come and see this. The entertainers were not paid. They were doing what was originally traditional dances, and they were set up into teams that competed. The teams represented different places of employment, and if you look at the signs on their shields or signs that they are holding in the air, sometimes it tells you where they work. The people sitting on the chairs are judges. They are actually chosen at random from the audience, and they were sat up front. There were usually three of them, and then they would vote on which team did the best job. They were completely unqualified to know anything about Zulu dancing, but that didn't seem to matter. They got the job anyway. We have an audience on that side, which is probably families of the dancers. These are the dancers. And the dancers use traditional moves. The costumes are supposed to be authentic, but I think that the idea of them all being uniform, that's a modern touch that's been added. If you could have heard the music that accompanies these, it's mostly drums. The leather shields are traditional. These will be the same people whose ancestors fought several wars against the people who came in from Europe. Their ancestors were moving southward as the people from Europe were moving northward, and they clashed several times in deciding who actually owned the territory. The area is now known as KwaZulu-Natal, so it's been settled that it's like a compromise. Natal was the name given by the Portuguese explorers because they discovered that territory actually on Christmas Day. And KwaZulu means the territory of the Zulus. the teams would try to outdo each other in color and energy, and they try to synchronize all their moves. These were traditional Zulu homes, as they were made in that part of the country, and they were open for the public to see. People actually lived there. That would be me in the middle there with my camera, taking your picture. MB on the shield indicates this is a team from the Metal Box Company, one of the largest makers of tin cans in South Africa. So they all know each other from work. They've all volunteered to be on this team and represent their business and compete against teams from other companies. So obviously to do this kind of a performance on Sunday afternoon, they had to practice during the week several times. That must have kept them busy. And very energetic. This guy has just gone a little bit crazy there. His job is just to hold the sign up, but he decided to get in on the act and dance too. The dancers are all men. That's because these dances were originally war dances, and the wars were fought by men. One group up, one group down. And now we're all down. This is a different group because they have a different shield. But the shield doesn't actually say who they work for. Some of the women have got in on the act too. Castle, now one of the world's largest brewing companies. Castle Brewery started in South Africa and expanded from there. Own breweries on every continent today under the name SAB. But Castle Breweries had their local team as well. So now we went to see the ocean, and down close to the beach is this water feature where children play in the paddling pool, and I think this girl was the daughter of some people that we met at the hotel. So they were there having fun and we were with them. Luantia had a similar fountain to that, and kids used to love to play in and under the fountain. The idea of being completely behind water curtain, it's quite enchanting to kids. In fact, I remember a kid's movie where the hero escapes from the villains by riding his horse behind the water curtain, and he can't be seen. He's behind the waterfall. And also there were dodgem cars, except that they weren't cars. They were actually power boats with little gasoline engines. And you could drive them around and crash into one another on the water if you chose. You could drive safely, but it was more fun crashing into other people. Now we're out at the beach. This would be the north part of Durban, I think. There's more rocky beaches there. Great rollers. Excellent surfing in that area. By today's standards, that beach is not at all crowded. Today there's an enormous number of people on the beach. You can hardly move. And as you can tell, the beaches were reserved at that time. That's long gone. Not to forget that this is actually a port city as well. We've got a major boat in the background there. Major ship. I apologize to all the navigators here. And so Durban had two sources of revenue. One, the port, the major port, and the other one, the tourism. Both doing well at that time. It's the same guy going the other way. Kind of unmistakable. And what are we doing? Apparently dogs were allowed on the beach then. Shallow water for the little ones. This was the first time I'd seen a trampoline. These ones were mounted in holes in the sand. And this park was on the the south end of the beach in Durban, getting close to the hospital area. Probably a good thing, too. I'm sure there were people hurt there. I'm probably the only person you know who actually had a trampoline split in half when he jumped on it. In my defense, it had been outdoors in all kinds of weather for a few years. The Bluff is a major feature in Durban on the south side of the harbor, and we're on the top of it and looking down. The Bluff was mostly off limits because it was a naval institution. There was a fence around it and you weren't allowed to go in or take pictures in that area. But outside there you could take pictures of the city, no problem. When I was a student later, one of my fellow students was involved in a project to put a pipeline underneath this harbor entrance. And she was the only woman on the team and was working on the south side, but had to cross the harbor to the north side every time she wanted to go to the bathroom, because they didn't have facilities for women on that side. So now you see the tourist area in the background, and we just saw the harbor in the foreground. With all those beaches, no wonder Durban is popular. This bird has found a tasty morsel. Somebody's left behind a fish tail. I believe this is one of those expanding fish that blows itself up, but had now blown itself back down again. They're quite poisonous to touch, I understand. Fishermen fishing from the pier, I notice they're sitting on the railway track. Doesn't look too safe. And here we have a warship entering the harbor. And there's my mother and me, and we're going to, or have just been on that ship as tourists. There are all kinds of tours arranged in that area. Later on, I came back to the same area to go to university, partly because I'd known the town from all these holidays. It's a little bit different, though, when you live there and study there. I often wonder what would have happened if I'd gone to Britain instead. That was my other alternative. In the days before containerization, this is how ships were loaded. All those wooden crates. As you can see, it's quite a busy harbor. It kept the city prosperous. The harbor was a secured customs zone, so there was a big fence around it. Watch the technique here for dropping the drums on the tire and hoping that they don't bounce off and smash the person on the other side of the tire. One of the drums actually falls off here as they're lifting it. So there's a drum missing there. Keep waiting for another one to drop, but it doesn't happen. Not on this lift, anyway. A ship of the Union Castle line. You can tell from the color of the paint on the hull, and also the black and red funnel. I haven't been able to read the name of that ship, and I wasn't really aware that the Union Castle line went up the east coast at all, but yes, it does. Well, it did. It went as far as Durban for sure, because this is Durban. Normally, the Union Castle line, in my mind, is associated with the run from Southampton to Cape Town, which was also the mail run. It took about 10 days, and anything that wasn't airmail was delivered that way, and paying passengers, who in those days brought in extra revenue, and it was cheaper than flying. It was actually cheaper to spend 10 days on a ship than to fly. Now we're at the Durban Aquarium, and my dad used this as his title shot for the scene. It's the person bringing food down to the fish. Some of them were fed underwater, and I'm not sure why, but that's what he did. We used to watch him through these side portals, and then you could watch them at three levels, two of which were below the waterline, And then you could also watch them from above. You can have a protuberance on your nose, or you can have it on your tail like a ray, and you have to live with that then. Must get in the way sometimes. Playing tag. How would you like that job? Going in there to feed the fish at their favorite depth. I'm not really sure why they had to do that. Durban by night. Claridge's Hotel, one of the more expensive hotels in town. The Edward was another one of the fine hotels close to the beach. Dodgems. Some of the spokes on this wheel don't light up at the right times, and the sign was like that for years and never got fixed. Not really sure why they didn't fix it. As you can see, the logo hasn't changed very much all down the years. Slachthaus, a butchery, literally place of slaughter. And the local nightclub And cigarette ad, a rich American blend. It's hard to read the second one, but it says rich American blend. And now I'm in the park that's more or less in the center of downtown Durban, close to the railway station, and not too far from the OK Bazaar. These pigeons have obviously become quite used to people. They're landing right on me, looking for something to eat. I have my trusty camera around my neck. I think what we have here is a couple of sailors who've had one too many. And they're being investigated by perhaps some of their own officers. And the feature here is the rickshaw. Rickshaws are not an African thing, but in Durban, rickshaws pulled by people in full Zulu regalia were a tourist thing. And occasionally, just to make your ride more interesting, they would jump up in the air so you'd be tilted backward, hoping that the balance of the thing would bring it back down again and not tip you right over on your back. I don't know that those would be there today. Probably not. This Japanese-style garden was a feature that people would also go and pay to visit. Very unusual for Africa. Ducks are ducks wherever you find them. The little ones follow along. I suppose they change color as they grow older. Rag Parade is an annual event operated by the students of the university. They would decorate these floats. They weren't pulled by trucks. The trucks were completely embedded inside the decorated float. And the Rag Parade was a fundraiser, really, for charity. Also an excuse for the students to have a party. Drink too much, simultaneously while building these things. So, as you can imagine, there were a few accidents. Don't be like Scrooge, give. Amazingly, these things were all constructed in a period of less than 24 hours, starting the afternoon before the parade. Whoever owned the trucks would bravely lend them to the students, and the students would then do whatever they needed to attach their structures to them, build on top of them. Here we've managed to get a marching band. Occasionally people would embed their entire car in the parade. So this is a mermaid. Although there was apartheid in the universities in South Africa, the university that we went to had taken advantage of a loophole in the law that allowed them to designate each campus for a different race. So you saw one float there operated by black students. And here, that's my mom in blue and my dad walking into the picture. So obviously brought his tripod. And I think he's planning to go fishing. This is at a holiday cottage south of Durban. And they are on vacation there at the same time that I was actually in university. So this would be only a couple of years before my mother died. Possibly a year before. I have her diary from the trip back from this vacation back to Luantia, and she wasn't doing too well then already. So that's the view from their holiday cottage. You had to cross the railway tracks to get to the ocean, as happens many places in the world. I believe that The cottage next to ours was also occupied by people from Luantia that we knew. Now we're at the home of somebody I met through the hotel, an entertainer, and visiting their home and meeting their children. She was a singer. Her husband was an entertainment manager at the Lonsdale Hotel at the time. I think her name was Jean. My father's beloved MG 1100. And that is the end.